And recognizing our poverty of spirit, recognizing our spiritual bankruptcy, is indispensable to becoming and enjoying the quality of life that we call the Christian life, where God, the fuel in the tank, comes to live within us.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean.
Come on, church, let's hear you.
This is your final boarding call for Israel 2016.
Don't miss out on this amazing experience. Reserve your place now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016.
Awaken in Israel. Imagine your journey. Immerse your senses. Ignite your faith. Awaken 2016 Israel is a once-in-a-lifetime exploration of origin and destiny. Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family as we travel to Israel. Immerse your senses. Experience the sights and sounds of the lands of the Bible. During this 10-day adventure, we'll visit Jerusalem, the Sea of Galilee, the Mount of the Beatitudes, the Dead Sea, as well as other amazing destinations. Ignite your faith through worship and the teaching of Charles and Hillary Price and special guests during a 2-day haven of reflection on the shore of the Sea of Galilee.
Join Charles and Hillary Price and the Living Truth family on a trip of a lifetime. This is your last chance to reserve your spot now for November 17th to the 27th, 2016. Visit awaken2016.com or call 1-877-465-3442. That's 1-877-465-3442.
Israel, awaken 2016. It's your time.
Almost 500 people traveled together to explore the land where Jesus walked. The journey culminated in a retreat on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, where Charles and Hillary Price shared the message of Jesus Christ. Living Truth is pleased to share this teaching series with you.
Have a word that is not only true to share together, but a word with you.
Marvelous thing about the scriptures, although we're all different individuals and we all have different backgrounds and we're facing different circumstances in life, yet we discover that the living, risen Lord Jesus Christ is relevant in every life and in every part of our lives. And we couldn't be in a more beautiful setting, of course, than to be right here by the Sea of Galilee. We'll never forget for the rest of our days the sights and the scenes and the smells and the sensations of this week and these 10 days that we're spending here in this beautiful place. Because God didn't just send us an idea. He didn't just send us a book. He sent us His Son, who lived, breathed, acted, ate, went to sleep, woke up again, and much of it around this lake. Although He was born in Bethlehem and then grew up in Nazareth and was known throughout His ministry as Jesus of Nazareth, they actually drove Him out of Nazareth the very first Saturday on the Sabbath day when He got up in the synagogue and began to speak, and He read a passage from the Old Testament in Isaiah about the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to preach good news to the poor. And they knew this was a messianic statement. And having read the passage, He closed the book and said, ladies and gentlemen, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. The implication was very evident. This is about me. Well, of course, they didn't like that. And they drove Him out of the city. Only once did He ever go back to Nazareth. And when He did, it says Jesus did not do any miracles in Nazareth because of their unbelief. And so He came down here to Capernaum on the shores of Galilee. And for the 3 years of His ministry, apart from probably an annual visit to Jerusalem, all His ministry was around this lake. This is where He performed many of the miracles. This is where He was out on the lake in the storm, two times in the storm. Once He stilled the storm, once He walked on the water in the storm. This is where He preached to 5,000 men, plus their wives and their kids. That's 10 times the size of this crowd. This is where He fed them with 5 loaves and 2 fish. He also around this lakeside spoke to 4,000 men. He fed them with 7 loaves and a few fish, it says. And so many of the stories that we know so well took place right here. Many of the parables He told around this lake. He went out into the water on a boat and spoke from the water. The acoustics were fantastic. We couldn't do it here. It would have been fun to have spoken from the lake. But we've got PA. Jesus didn't need it. He had the acoustics of the water. But what I want to do this morning is look at one of the events that took place around the lake. Let me first tell you a story of a man who telephoned his friend, and his friend's little boy answered the phone. And when the little boy answered the phone, he said in almost a whisper, "Hello." And the man said, "Is your dad there?" "No." "Where is he?" "He's with my mom." "What's he doing?" "They're with a policeman." "What are they doing with the policeman?" "They're talking to the firefighter." "And what are they doing with the policeman talking to the firefighter?" "They're waiting for the helicopter pilot who's just arriving." He said, "You mean your dad is with your mum? They're talking to a policeman and a fireman about a helicopter pilot who's just arriving? What's going on?" "They're looking for me." I wonder if you're here on this trip. You're looking at the sights and enjoying the atmosphere, but you're hiding. You may be looking for Jesus here in the sense. This is where He was. And by the way, there's lots of stories about where He was supposed to be. And if there was any authenticity, somebody slapped a church on it. So you really don't get the real feeling of what it was like. But you know what's more true than coming here to walk in the footsteps of Jesus and see the places that were important to him? He's looking for you. Now, you may be a Christian, as most of us here this morning are. But he's still looking for you. You know, a verse we often quote, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and open the door, I'll come in, I'll sup with him." That is, I'll have fellowship and friendship with him. You know, that was written to Christians in the church in Laodicea. And although you're Christian, he says, "I'm outside." You're busy, you're active, you've got lots of activity, but you kept me outside. One of the most concentrated records that we have in the entire Gospels of anything Jesus said was when he preached the Sermon on the Mount, which he did near this lake. But let me read you from Matthew chapter 4 and verse 23. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, that is up in the north of the lake, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. Large crowds from Galilee, that's on the west side of the lake, the Decapolis, were in the area that was known as the Decapolis. Jerusalem, Judea, and the region across the Jordan followed him. Now, when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." And these are words that Jesus spoke up on a hillside over my right shoulder somewhere. And that was the beginning of the three chapters we call the Sermon on the Mount. And he begins by repeating nine times this word, blessed, blessed are, blessed are, blessed are, blessed are. Well, that probably doesn't excite us very much, because this word blessed has become a very vague, almost meaningless word to many of us. We use it, but we use it in a kind of fill-in-the-blank sense. You know, you get up in the morning, you say, "Lord, please bless today." What do you mean? Well, give me a good day. You know, look after me today. You go to eat your breakfast, and before you eat it, you say, "Lord, please bless the food." What do you mean? I don't know. My mother used to say that. And so we just say it. And then maybe you have a time of prayer, and you want to pray for the missionaries. You say, "Lord, please bless the missionaries." I don't know what that means, but do it to them anyway. And then you know, somebody sneezes and you say, "Bless you." And then, you know, if you're at home and you're out for the day, you get home and you put some meat out for the meal that night, and the cat has jumped onto the counter and has begun to eat the meat, and you say, "That blessed cat has eaten the food." And we use this word in all kinds of almost meaningless ways. But actually, the word has a meaning. And the Greek word in which the New Testament was written, though Jesus spoke Aramaic, but the text was written down in Greek, the Greek word makarios means literally to be happy. That's its literal meaning. So he's saying these nine times, happy is, happy are, happy will be, happy is. Now, the translators have usually not used that word because in English, to be happy has sort of connotations of something a little bit superficial. It's a nice, hot, sunny day like today. We're down on the beach. You've got an ice cream in one hand. You've got a girl in the other. And you're happy. All your circumstances are good. But a thick black cloud floats across the sky, stops above you, drops cold, wet raindrops on you. The ice cream falls into the sand and the girl walks away. You're not happy anymore. And we tend to think of happiness as being this sort of superficial, nice feeling while it lasts. But that is not the meaning of the word makarios. Rather, it's speaking about a deep inner sense of contentment and satisfaction that is there irrespective where the sun is shining or the rain is falling, irrespective whether the sky is blue or the sky is black. And you know, if that's what Jesus is talking about in these verses, it's interesting that the people who came and listened to him were those who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain. They were demon-possessed. They're those who had seizures. They're those who were paralyzed. I mean, this was every Tom, Dick, and Harry, and Mary with every kind of problem, and every kind of issue, and every kind of frustration that many of us probably have today. And he stood up in front of them and said, if you want to know what it takes to be happy, Makarios style, there's certain things you need to understand which are in complete and utter contrast with what we normally look for when we're normally looking for happiness. You see, if you look through this list, there's some surprises in this in the ingredients that Jesus gives for happiness. You know, when he starts off, blessed are the poor. Now he says poor in spirit, but whoever heard of poverty making somebody happy? Why do people play the lottery every week? Because they think, if I could just be rich. And you can hardly go into a gas station in Toronto or into a convenience store and somebody in front of you isn't buying a lottery ticket of some kind. I was in a line with some folks just recently. Two people, they both were buying tickets. And I said to the man in front of me, how much do you spend on tickets? He said, I only spend about $5 a week. That's all. Okay. 50 weeks a year, that's $250 a year. How much do you win? Well, not yet. I haven't won anything. I said, you know something? I win, on average, about $250 every year on the lottery. He said, you do? I said, yes. He said, what's the secret? I don't buy any tickets. I'm $250 richer for not buying it. But you see, why do people do this? Because they think that there's a key to my finding what I'm looking for in life, and it's getting rich. Now said Jesus, blessed, happy are the poor. We're talking about what he means by poor in spirit. And then he says an even more strange one, blessed or happy are those who mourn. Wow, that's a strange one. If you met somebody who said, look, I'm really feeling miserable today. I wish somebody would die. That would cheer me up. You'd say, this is a little strange. Blessed or happy are the meek. I mean, meek sounds pathetic, doesn't it? You know, excuse me for being alive kind of feeling. Blessed, happy are the meek. Really? I want to be tough. I want to be strong. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Whoever heard of hungering and thirsting making you happy? Normally it's getting what you're hungering for that makes you happy, isn't it? And you go through this list and you say to yourself, this is not a useful list of things that make me happy. It ends up, blessed are those who are persecuted, and finishes, blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, falsely say all kinds of things against you. Whoever heard of somebody saying, look, I'm a bit down, would you please insult me? Would you please beat me up? Would you please go and gossip about me? That'll make me feel better. What in the world is Jesus talking about? Well, of course, as I've already said, when you look more closely, he doesn't say blessed are the poor in pocket, but the poor in spirit. Well, what does that even mean? Not blessed are those who hunger and thirst for a decent, you know, hamburger. But blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. What does that mean? He talks about theirs is the kingdom of heaven. What in the world is that? He talks about they will see God in one of these Beatitudes. Well, what he's saying, of course, is this. The true happiness is not going to be found in the area most people are looking for it. That is in the physical, material things. But real happiness is going to be found when you realize it is something in the spiritual realm that is interior to yourself, not external, but internal. We have a spiritual capacity that reaches outside of ourselves in which we're designed to know and experience and enjoy God. That is what makes human beings unique. And it is in the spirit capacity or the spiritual part of our lives that we find the meaning and the purpose and the fulfillment and the satisfaction that makes life make sense. Jay Gould was a multimillionaire, one of the richest people in his day, lived in the United States. And he famously said, "I think I must be the most miserable man living." He had everything materially, but there's an emptiness. I've been in areas of the world where people live in absolute poverty, and yet there's a sense of contentment and completion. Why? Because they know God, and they experience God. That isn't to justify or leave alone their poverty, but it's the fact that that is not where meaning and purpose and fulfillment is found. And here on this hillside over on my right shoulder, with crowds of folks coming from Decapolis down here, Galilee on the west, Syria up in the north, some of them coming up from Judea and Jerusalem. Jesus sat down on the hillside and said, "Let me tell you what you're looking for. You're not here for a show. Jesus was not an entertainer. He wasn't there to perform for them. You're here because you're looking for something. You're looking for meaning. You're looking for fulfillment. You're looking for satisfaction. Some of you are here because you want healing. But let me first tell you what you really need." And he gave these ingredients for real happiness. We'll look at just a couple of them this morning. First one, he says in verse 3, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." What that means is simply this. Happy, blessed is the person who realizes, I don't have what it takes in myself. I am totally inadequate within myself. As Paul later wrote in Romans chapter 7, verse 18, "I know that nothing good lives in me." That is in my flesh, say some translations, my natural self. That seems a pretty devastating statement to make, doesn't it? I know nothing good lives in me. I mean, I can read that to you, and then at the end of this meeting, we're chatting, and you say to me, "Hey, you said something this morning I really agree with you about." "Oh, really? What was that?" "You said nothing good lives in you." And I noticed. I agree with you. How would you expect me to respond and say, "Oh, thank you very much"? No, I'd probably say, "Hey, listen, that's a bit of doctrine, but I don't really believe that. I mean, do we really believe this? Isn't this very negative? Aren't there good things about us? What about the ability to love? Isn't that a good thing?" Of course it is. A lot of people love. "What about the ability to do a good day's work? Isn't that a good thing?" Of course it is. "What about the ability to paint a beautiful picture? Isn't that a good thing?" Of course it is. So what does Paul mean when he says, "In me there dwells no good thing"? Let me illustrate. Supposing I got a brand new car, and being British, let's say it was a Rolls Royce. And the Rolls Royce Phantom, I think, is one of their biggest and best. Supposing it was my favorite color for a car, white with black strip down the side, red flames at the back. It had leather upholstery, state-of-the-art, surround sound, DVD, in the back seat, of course. Even a bar in the back seat, satellite tracking. And suppose I parked this car outside my home and you came by my home, you'd say, wow, look at that. Wow, that is some car. And you might be impressed. But supposing I had no gasoline, or petrol, as we say in the Holy Land, I mean in England. Same thing. If I have no gasoline, it'll still be my favorite color, still be the Rolls-Royce Phantom, it'll still have its leather upholstery, it'll still have its DVD set and its surround sound, its satellite tracking. But if you said to me, can I come for a ride in your car? I'd look a little embarrassed and say, well, I'm not going anywhere at the moment. Well, can you tell me when you're going? Well, actually, I don't know when I'm going to go. Because you see, without gasoline in the car, everything about the car that's good would be good for keeping chickens in, but nothing more. You couldn't go anywhere. And when Paul says, in me there dwells no good thing, when Jesus said, blessed, happy are those who recognize that they do not have what it takes, they are poor in spirit. He's not saying, hey, you're just of no value. But he's saying that in your natural state, you may be a phantom Rolls Royce, but there's no gasoline in the tank and you do not have the ability to be what you are supposed to be. Let me read you what C.S. Lewis wrote in his book, Mere Christianity. He said, God made us or invented us as a man invents an engine. A car is made to run on petrol, meaning gasoline, and it would not run properly on anything else. Now, God designed the human machine to run on himself. He himself is the fuel our spirits were designed to burn, and the food our spirits were designed to feed on. There is no other. That is why it's no good asking God to make us happy without himself. God cannot give us happiness and peace apart from himself because it is simply not there. There is no such thing, says C.S. Lewis. And recognizing our poverty of spirit, recognizing our spiritual bankruptcy is indispensable to becoming and enjoying the quality of life that we call the Christian life, where God, the fuel in the tank, comes to live within us. Listen carefully for a moment. I meet many Christian people who don't grasp that this is what the gospel is about. We often limit the gospel to being about forgiving us of our sin, essential, necessary as that is, to get us into heaven when we die, wonderful as that prospect is. We've not understood the gospel about filling the tank with gasoline. It's getting God back into human experience. So that it's God himself on whom we rely and depend and trust. You see, in Psalm 16 in verse 2, David wrote there, you are my Lord, and apart from you, I have no good thing. Because it is you, your presence in me, the gasoline in the tank that makes everything else about me that is already good, effective and fruitful. And the marvelous thing is, Jesus said, if you face your poverty of spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. This opens the door to all the riches of the kingdom and the working of Christ in our lives. And this Jesus told the crowd who met with him up on the hill over my right shoulder. And then he said this, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. You see, when you face your poverty, and God has his own wonderful way of exposing it to us, sometimes it's painful, the process of realizing and backing into a corner to realize, I just don't have what it takes in myself to be what I'm supposed to be. Some of you may be discovering that through very difficult times. Then said Jesus, When you face your poverty of spirit, you can do one of two things. You can hide it. You can pretend you're not really like that. Put on a facade. Or you can face it honestly and mourn it. This is not talking about funerals and bodies. It's talking about our response to facing our poverty of spirit is that we face it honestly and we mourn it. This is what we call repentance. You know, repentance is something far deeper than being sorry for what we do. Most people can be sorry for what they do, especially when they're found out. This is deeper than that. It's recognizing that I do what I do because I am what I am. And my problem is not what I do. That is only the symptom. My problem is what I am. You may have heard it said before, a person is not a sinner because they commit sins. They commit sins because they are a sinner. Does that make sense? You can be born as a beautiful little baby, and we have three kids, and they were all beautiful when they were born. They still are. But they were born separated from the life of God. We didn't teach them how to sin, how to be naughty. It was a natural gift. It's hereditary. Through the mother. You see, you and I are born in a state of separation from God. We have to understand that is the diagnosis that is the beginning. As a result, we sin, we fail. But that's only the symptom. And Christ didn't come to deal only with the symptom. He does deal with the symptom by dealing with the cause. And when you face your poverty of spirit, you mourn that poverty. That is, as I said just now, what repentance is. And repentance is not just saying, I'm sorry for what I've done. It is a change of mind that turns from living in independence of God to living in dependence upon God, turns from living by my own strength to live in His strength, turns from living my life my way to live my life His way, turns from giving sin acceptable names and excuses and calling it what God calls it. It's a disposition, an attitude of heart. You see, there is a beginning, of course, to our repentance. And usually we begin that by realizing what the symptoms are. And I don't like them. And I say, I'm sorry for them. But it has to go more deeper than that. Into it's what I am, my disposition, my basic condition and my disposition towards God is one of mourning my own condition. And those who mourn will be comforted, said Jesus. Comforted by whom? Very simply, by the Comforter. Who's the Comforter? It's a name that Jesus gave to the Holy Spirit. It's the word is parakletos in the Greek. It's not an easy word to translate. It translates as comforter, counselor, advocate. There's no exact equivalent in English, but it is the same word that Jesus uses here. Blessed are those who mourn. They will be parakaleo. It's the same word, because when we face our poverty and we mourn our poverty, it's at that point that the Holy Spirit has access into our lives to replace what we are with what He is. He replaces our poverty with the riches of Jesus Christ. He replaces our weakness with the strength of Jesus Christ. He replaces our defeat with the victory of Jesus Christ. He replaces our sin with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you something, that is very comforting. Because it's not, all right, you've forgiven me. Now, I promise you, God, I'm going to live a good life as best I can. That's a waste of time. You'll never do that. You don't have the capacity to. But in facing our poverty and mourning it, we then allow the Comforter, the Spirit of God in us, to do what only the Spirit of God in us can do, which is to live the life of Jesus Christ in us. And to do the work of Jesus Christ through us. That's why Paul writes in summarizing the Christian life, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And it's His presence in me that is the source of everything that becomes good and effective and fruitful. And all of this, Jesus told the crowd upon the hill over my right shoulder. A crowd who are aware of all kinds of needs. Physical needs were often a symptom of that, but the needs were deep. And he said, if you want to be really complete and whole and happy and blessed, Macario style, understand your poverty, mourn your poverty, and at that point, the comforter will begin to work in your life. What happens next? Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. What does it mean to be meek? It doesn't mean to be weak. In my dictionary, it says to be meek is to be humble and to be submissive. You face your poverty, you mourn your poverty, the comforter gets to work in your life, and your response is one of humility and meekness, where you surrender in submission to Jesus Christ as our Lord. You know, we talk a lot about Jesus being our Savior, and rightly so, because He is wonderfully our Savior. But you know, He's spoken of as being Savior 24 times in the New Testament. He's spoken of as being Lord over 600 times. And wonderfully true it is that He saves us. He saves us when we so face our poverty, mourn it, the Spirit of God gets to work within our hearts, and we submit and we recognize Jesus Christ is Lord. That is the slogan, if you like, of the early church. We're talking this morning at breakfast to couple of us about the meaning of ichthus, the sign of the fish. Ichthus are the letters. Ichthus is the Greek word for fish. And the letters were letters that meant Jesus Christ is Lord. And in the Roman Empire, as in English, you would say J-C-I-L would be an acrostic for Jesus Christ is Lord. The Greek words for Jesus Christ is Lord spelt the name of fish, which was ichthus. So in the catacombs, you'll find little signs of fish. And they're just saying to those who understood, Jesus Christ is Lord. Because that is, I was going to say, the mantra of the gospel. But that is what the gospel is about. You see, Paul wrote in Romans 14 and verse 9, for this very reason, Christ died and returned to life so that, what? So that He might be Lord of both the dead and the living. It's wonderfully true He saves us. But don't detach His saviorhood from His lordship, because as Savior, that is part of what He does when He comes to be who He really is, which is Lord. Let me illustrate this. Hillary, my wife, is a very wonderful lady. Her favorite time is not spent in the kitchen. But she cooks good food and keeps me alive and healthy and sometimes a little overweight. That's my fault, though. And so Hillary has cooked in our home for 30 years. I have once or twice bought an egg or something. Now, Hillary is a great cook. But supposing I was to introduce her to you, and you hadn't met her already, and I was to say to you, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like you to meet my cook, what do you think she'd say? Well, I'll tell you what she'd say. So I beg your pardon, what do you say? Well, I was just introducing you. But who do you say I was? Well, I said you're my cook. I'm not your cook. But you cook for me, don't you? I mean, I bought you a cooker. And a cookbook. Of course you cook for me. She said, but I'm not your cook, I'm your wife. And so she is. When we talk about Jesus as our personal Savior, be very careful we're not saying He's my cook, when He's your Lord. When we got married 30 years ago, I didn't stand in front of a crowd of people and say, I take you to be my personal cook. I said, I take you to be I take you to be my lawfully wedded wife. And when she became my wife, do you know what I discovered? I got a cook. And a multitude of other things. But she's not my cook, that would be an insult. That's part of what she does for our family. When Jesus Christ comes to live in you, he comes to be in you and in me what he is. What is he? He is Lord. He wonderfully saves us. But if our interest in Jesus Christ is just to get us off the hook and get us washed up on the shores of heaven one day, and then we'll start to enjoy things, we've not begun to understand the gospel. It's facing our poverty, mourning our poverty, allowing the comfort of the Spirit of God to get to work in us to replace what we are with what Christ is, and then living in meek submission to Christ as Lord. And that means he's going to mess our lives around a little bit. It'll feel that way, but it won't be messing around. It'll be smartening them up. Let me read you something else C.S. Lewis said. C.S. Lewis said that 6 months after I became a Christian, God began to change my life around and adjust everything. It was like having the builders in the house. Well, that was okay. I thought they'd put a bit of paint here, they'd repair some damage there, maybe enlarge a window or two, and generally make the house a little better than it was. Instead, I found they were knocking down walls, they were changing the stairs around, they're putting up new light fittings, the house was chaos. And I said to the Lord, Lord, what are you doing? And he said to me, didn't you know I'm turning your little shack into a palace? Sometimes we want Jesus in the shack. Yeah, sure, a bit of paint will be okay, a little touch here and a touch there. No, said God in Lewis's analogy there, I'm changing your shack into something different. And that means I'm going to knock some walls down. I'm going to change some things. You know, of all the crowds who walked around the lake with Jesus and met him here, and it speaks often of crowds gathering around the lake side, very few of them understood and went the whole way with him. Because after 3 years of ministry, having been crucified, buried, risen again, 40 days later, ascending to his Father, he left behind 120 people from Judea, Jerusalem, and some came down from the north. There may have been a few other genuine disciples scattered around up in Galilee somewhere, but 120 people waiting for the gift of the Holy Spirit he told them to wait for on the day of Pentecost. 120 people after 3 years of ministry is less than one convert per week who really meant business. They're always the crowds. And often when Jesus spoke to the crowd, he would send many of them away just because what he said was so demanding, because he was saying, look, the terms of this is that you receive a new Lord and a new Master. Many walked no more with him, it says in John chapter 6. On one notable occasion. And he turned to the disciples who alone were left and said, you also can go if you want. You don't have to stay. You go. And Peter, who often said the wrong thing, said the right thing. Where should we go? You have the words of eternal life. We're staying. What does it cost? And the 10 lepers who Jesus healed, 9 of them enjoyed their new liberty and their new health. Only one came back to say thank you. Symptomatic of the fact he came back to say, Lord Jesus Christ, this was what you have done. I am grateful to you, and therefore my gratitude to you is an acknowledgement of my dependence on you. What do you want? Many people came asking for the right things. A rich young ruler came. What must I do to receive eternal life? What about the commandments? All these I've kept since I was young, said the young man. One thing you lack, said Jesus, you're a rich man, sell your possessions, give them away, then come and follow me. Not because riches are wrong, but no man can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and mammon. You'll love the one, you'll hate the other. And so he diagnosed in this man that his riches were his master. And he said, unless you get rid of your riches, you can't be my disciple. And what Jesus had diagnosed was so evidently true, because the man went away. And went away sad, it says, because he had great wealth. And Jesus didn't run after him and say, hey, come back, come back, come back. Sorry, I didn't mean to frighten you like that. Whew, that was a bit tough, wasn't it? Hey, let's start at a lower level. Would you like to have your sins forgiven? You haven't broken many laws, so you must have some. Come on, some teeny ones you have. Okay. Would you like to go to heaven when you die? Good. Put that one down. Now, when I come to change your life. I really have plans for your life. Would you like my plans? Depends what they are, you say. Well, okay, for an example, you're rich, aren't you? Yeah. I've got some things I can do with your money. Would you like me to do that? You've already got plans made. You sure? You're happy with them? Okay, fine. No, leave that one out. You're single? Okay. Would you like me to decide who you should marry? Beg your pardon? What's her name, you say? Well, she mightn't have a name, actually, because I might want you to be single, but do you want my will or yours? You can handle that. Okay, okay, fine, no problem. That's okay. I'll leave that one out. When I send to my Father, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to fill my disciples. Would you like to be filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? Beg your pardon? As long as nothing funny happens, you say? Okay, all right. Well, I'll tell you what to do. Stand in the corner, keep your hands in your pocket and your mouth shut, and maybe we'll try and make it nice and easy for you. But by the look of this, what you really want, you want to have your sins forgiven. You haven't got many anyway, but you like them forgiven, and you like to go to heaven when you die. Is that what you want? Yeah, that's what you want. Okay. Well, listen, welcome to the family. At least if you get sat on by a camel, you'll know where you're going. And it may be later you want to come back and get rededicated because you may want a bit more, but at least you've got the basics. Is that what Jesus said? No. That's what we say. He sent him away with an empty hand. Because the Lord Jesus never deceived anybody into thinking you've got it right when they haven't. He never deceived people into thinking, okay, I'm Mr. Santa Claus. What's your need? I'm the cure-all doctor. What's your problem? Where are you sick? And that's what it's all about. No. I have come to restore to you the life of God that was lost in the fall, and the life of God in you comes to not only empower you and to enable you and to equip you, but to reign within your life. And the interesting thing is, Jesus said, those who are meek will inherit the earth. That's interesting. It doesn't say, blessed are the meek, they'll inherit heaven. Though they will. But they'll inherit the earth. What do you mean? Life on earth will begin to make sense because God has plans for our lives here and now on earth. And when you submit to Christ, you'll discover that he will direct your paths and guide you, and he will put you in the right place at the right time for the right reason with the right people. And you may not understand it at the time. You may not be able to interpret it. You may not be able to stand up and give testimony about what God has done in your life. You may not see very much, but you can be sure of this. If you're submitted to Christ, he is using you. Many folks in the Bible never saw what God was doing with their lives. Some do, some don't. But it's that submission to Christ and life on earth makes sense. And these are the things that Jesus told the crowd of folks who met him on the hillside over my right shoulder here. And the things the same Lord Jesus Christ says to you and to me. And we're going to stop at this point. But you know, when I first became a Christian, I'm very grateful for all those who explained the gospel to me. I became a Christian, and for 4 years, I was glad that I was going to go to heaven if a bus were to run over me. And that was the primary benefit. Phew. I'm going to be okay. And I wondered why the Christian life was so boring when the New Testament talked about it being so rich. I've come that you might have life and life more abundantly. I didn't know that in experience. If any man's in Christ, he's a new creation. The old things have passed away. All things have become new. I didn't know that in experience. Because having been forgiven, going to heaven when I die. In the meantime, yes, I'll try and please him. Yes, I'll do the right things. Yes, I'll keep the rules. But I had not understood that when I became a Christian, what God gave to me was himself by his Holy Spirit to live in me the life of Jesus Christ. And it was in humble dependence on him. He'd say, Lord, I can't live this life. I can't accomplish what you want to accomplish, but you can. And I look to you and I trust you and I depend on you. And you allow him to work in us and through us. And this is what was so exciting. And one day Jesus took his disciples together the day before he was crucified. And he said to them, you read this in John 14 and 15, I myself can do nothing. And they probably thought to themselves, Well, that's crazy. We saw you walk on the water. We saw you raise Lazarus from the dead. What do you mean you can do nothing? Three times she said, I myself can do nothing. Then he said this, my Father in me, he does the work. In John 14:10, I abide in my Father remains in me, and the words I speak to you, they're not my own. Rather, it is the Father living in me who's doing his work. And then he said in chapter 15, the chapter visions were not put there by the original writers, of course. It's one continuous thing. They've been put there for our convenience, but sometimes they get in the way. Chapter 15, he says, and listen, as I abide in the Father, and the Father abides in me, and the words and works I speak are not my own, it's the Father in me doing his work. So as you abide in me, and I abide in you, you will bear much fruit, because without me, you can do nothing. Disciples, I want you to understand this, that the Christian life is you being in a relationship with me of utter dependence on me as I am in a relationship of dependence on my Father. I can do nothing myself. You can do nothing yourself. My Father in me, he does the works, and it'll be me by my Spirit in you. It'll do the works in and through you. And I'll tell you, that means you can rest and relax. It's not what I do for Jesus. It's what I let Jesus himself do in and for and through me. And that becomes exciting. That becomes alive. And Jesus taught this over here on the hillside, around this lake. And he's still teaching it through his word and by his Spirit.
Someone who would benefit from this message. Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel.
Next week, Charles Price continues this Holy Land series recorded on location in Israel.
How great thou art. Let's stand, let's sing, let's worship.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand made. I see the stars, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed.
And sings my soul,
then sings my soul.
Thou art.
How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in.
That on the cross,
that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin.
Then sings my soul,
then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. when Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart? Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, then sings my soul.